Welcome back. We'll try to stick to a schedule here. We're still 15 minutes behind, though. So our first speaker will be introduced by James McKenna from Anthropology.
Well, I think this is the right time this time. So anyway, it gives me great pleasure to introduce a very, very close friend of mine, Wenda Trevathan, who I met in 1979. And she did her very lovely thesis on attachment and the first hour of birth in human babies. And Wenda has, through the years, been a wonderful contributing colleague to the American Association of Physical Anthropology and made enormous contributions to our appreciation of the way in which you could very positively construct evolutionary models, both of parenting and infancy. And I've been lucky enough and privileged to have her co-author several books on evolutionary medicine. And she has done a teeny bit of work on the evolution of menopause, but not very much, and she wanted to make that clear. But in any event, I give you my friend, Dr. Wenda Trevathan. Welcome, Wenda.
Thank you, Jim. When I gave this first conference talk, this was at the American Association of Physical Anthropologists, we had 15 minutes or something like that. And afterwards, Jim's advice to me, this is when I first met him, was, Wenda, you don't have to do your entire dissertation in 15 minutes. So I've taken that to heart, and I'll try not to present my entire dissertation or whatever has happened in the ensuing years in the 30 minutes that I'm allotted. But what I am going to talk about is birth in the first postnatal hour, and it, you might notice in the schedule, I called this birth in the first hour of life. I thought the idea of the first hour of life was really a wonderful concept, but unfortunately it has obtained a great deal of ambiguity lately, and so I decided to make it less ambiguous. I would refer to it as the first postnatal hour or the first hour after birth. There are a lot of things that go on in this first hour after birth. Several of them we've alluded to already. But for a long time, biomedicine at least, and I know I'm stereotyping here, but biomedicine focused most on neonatal adaptation. We've got to take care of the baby in this immediate postpartum period. We've got to make sure it survives. With the movement toward more humane birth, if you will, in the 1950s and 1960s and 1970s, people began to become concerned about maternal experience and having a rewarding experience at birth. And we were sort of patted on our heads and said, well, that would be nice, but the most important thing is to have a live, healthy baby. So if you have a nice experience with that, that's fine, but we really want to focus on the health of the baby. But we now know from a lot of the research that many of you all are involved in and that we've talked about today that there's a lot else that's going on. A lot of things can happen in this immediate postpartum period in a healthy, quote, normal delivery that have perhaps lifelong effects on the infant and the mother. So I think we really, my bottom line message of this is I think we need to pay some attention to this period of time. We kind of gave up on that a few years ago because of the controversies about the first hour after birth and its importance for mother-infant bonding. But I think there's still some things we need to pay some attention to. So I'd like to start off by thinking about what birth may have been like in the EEA. Fortunately, with this audience, I don't have to constantly say, of course, I wasn't there in the EEA. I can't really tell you what was going on. We're never going to prove this was happening. But as anthropologists, at least, we look at cross-cultural information to try to understand, try to get back at what that may have been like. We look at cross-species examples, such as some of the primate examples we've been talking about today. And whenever possible, we try to make whatever observations we can of humans sort of stripped, can never be stripped of cultural, but they can be stripped of technological kinds of interventions. So this was what I did in trying to construct what I think birth was like in the EEA. I guess the EEA that we're talking about is the Pleistocene, which is a little bit after this sketch, but it does show us one aspect, I think, of what happened certainly during labor in the EEA was that women were still pretty active. They were moving along. They were walking in labor. This is another concern we have about how to actually have a good birth experience or whatever, walking in labor, keeping up with others. But in doing my dissertation work many, many years ago, what I wanted to do was try to come up with a description of what happened during birth. And so I did what I refer to as an ethological study. In fact, the dissertation was entitled Maternal Behavior in the First Hour After Birth. This was in an out-of-hospital setting. Again, no way to strip humans of culture, but I tried to find a setting in which we didn't have a lot of the technological interventions that were often associated with birth, at least in the 1970s and 1980s. So these were in home-like settings. In the year that I did my observations, this was in El Paso, Texas, where most of the women who were delivering in this birth center were from Mexico. They were coming across the border to have their babies in what was a safe environment by their understanding of it, and also inexpensive. So these were women, but for the most part were motivated by different kinds of reasons that women often were choosing home birth in the United States. These were women that hadn't read every single book that had ever come out on birthing and so on. They were typical average people, again, whatever that might mean. But their motivations, I think, were a little bit different. So again, I felt like I was seeing a little bit more insight into what a natural childbirth might have been like. I will warn you that I've got some graphic settings, photographs ahead of a delivery that I was able to record photographically. This was before we could easily videotape things like this, so it's still photographs. But maybe after dinner it's a little graphic for some of you. But anyway, we'll see what happens. Anyway, this is one of the things that I think was probably a characteristic of birth in the EEA. It certainly is almost universally in human cultures today, and that is that other people are present. We'll talk about the contrast with most other animals, where birth tends to be a solitary event, but it is a social event for humans. If you'll see this, what's going on here, this is the little head just emerging. The baby's face is facing down toward, in this case, the bottom of the bed, toward the mother's anus as it is emerging. And I will argue in a minute that that's one of the crucial reasons, if you will, that birth tends to be attended by other people in humans, in contrast to most other animals. So there tend to be companions at birth. That would be what I would argue. Another thing that occurs with birth in a lot of home birth settings and in many cultures across the world is that the umbilical cord is not cut until the cord has stopped pulsing. So that's another observation you might make if you've been able to be present at a birth in this imaginative EEA. But you can see this is just seconds after the mother has delivered the baby. She's clearly pretty happy about this. She's holding the baby, and the midwife is testing the cord to see if it stopped pulsing, because by the standards of the center that I was working at, they did not cut it unless they had to because of nuchal wrapping. Eye contact is very important in that first hour. You know, what I was doing was I was observing these animals as if I was observing other primates. I wasn't interacting with the mothers in a vocal kind of sense or interviewing or anything like that. I was just looking and recording at what I was doing. And I think Allison was mentioning the important contacts. I was recording information on eye contact, on lateral preference, on the amount of time touching the baby, and the actual process of touching, and the placement of the baby, where the mother held the baby, left or right. But you can see in this picture that eye contact, you can certainly see some sort of straining, some sort of effort to make contact on the part of the mother. So one of the conclusions from mine and many other studies as well is that eye contact is very important in this first hour after birth. And the infant is also making eye contact. In my observations, I was looking at human maternal behavior in the first hour after birth. So I was at the foot of the bed. I was actually behind a one-way mirror, had full informed consent and all that kind of stuff. But anyway, I was behind a one-way mirror. I could not usually see the baby's face, but in the photographs that I took of this one, which this woman was not in my study, at least as the dissertation research was concerned, I saw many, many instances of the baby looking apparently straight into the mother's eyes. And we now know from research of many people that the baby can focus in a fairly short length. So although they're altricial, they're certainly born with eyes open and taking in all kinds of information. The mother does a lot of hand kinds of things, a lot of exploring of the infant's body, a lot of rubbing, a lot of massaging, and I'll talk about the significance of that in many ways, very similar to the licking of mothers that we've talked about today, this morning. And then she also spends quite a lot of time fully encompassing the baby, holding the baby, keeping it warm. And Jan Winberg has referred to this as the maternal nest that the mother is holding the baby in. And all this is happening within the first hour. This is probably within the first 20 or 30 minutes, I would guess, this sequence of slides that you've seen. There's also very commonly nursing beginning within an hour after birth. The midwives I worked with believed that it was important to establish nursing breastfeeding early. to contribute to greater success later, and they also felt there was a much quicker recovery of the uterine bleeding and things like that if they did. So I can't say that this was a natural latching on that was done, but the baby was clearly rooting and searching around the breast without any kind of encouragement from the mother or from the midwives. And again, we're familiar with that whole concept. Sue Carter set me up for this one by saying we need to change the way birth is occurring, and I really appreciate that because I have some ideas about how we can do this. And this is stuff we're all familiar with. I have not come up with anything new here. We've all been talking about this for a long, long time, but I'm discouraged to learn that, if anything, we tend to be going backwards in some ways. And stuff that I thought was really beginning to change in the late 80s and on into the 90s appears to be kind of going the other direction in a number of ways. So we still have some work to do. But these are at least five characteristics. I think there's a whole lot more, but at least five characteristics from the EEA, from our imaginative EEA, that I think are worth preserving. Having companionship at birth. People who are there for the emotional support of the women. I mean, clearly some sort of physical or technological assistance is often warranted. But someone there whose sole purpose of being there is the emotional support. And incidentally, this is not necessarily the father of the baby or the husband or the partner of the woman, because what they found over and over again is a lot of times it's very important for that person to be there for the mother, but if anything, he, in most cases, causes more anxiety for her than say, a doula would, the supportive companion. Delivery in the squatting or upright position. The woman in the photograph that you saw was in a semi-sitting position. The problem for those of us who dream that we're going to deliver in the squatting position is that we spend virtually none of our lives squatting. And so we don't have the muscle development that's important for that, and we probably can't do that. So we need to at least be semi-upright. And I think I read recently that a 30% angle is probably a good compromise between the things that you gain from the upright position and the abilities that we have as people who don't squat a lot in our everyday lives able to do that. The cord is cut when it stops pulsating, and I'll talk about each one of these individually. Another important thing is that whenever possible, the mother and infant are together in the first hour after birth, and there's a lot of evidence that a lot of the things that need to be done, that someone thinks need to be done to a baby in the first hour after birth, can be done while the mother is holding it. So separation is rarely warranted, although I will admit that it sometimes is. And breastfeeding initiated soon after birth. So let's look at the supportive companions. This is the one that I've structured much of my research, but arguments in the last 20 years, the ones that Jim and others are familiar with. And first has a lot to do with the difficulty of birth. And there is some debate about whether it really is difficult, whether this is just a product of our culture where we're afraid of birth, we never experience birth till we give it, or whether there really is something challenging about birth. And I'm still in the camp that there is something objectively challenging about delivery. But this is true for many, many primates. And this is an instance where the chimpanzee and the bonobo, the gorilla and the orangutan are not our best models for birth, because these are large-bodied animals with little-headed babies. And birth and delivery, labor and delivery, are pretty easy. I mean, I'm not saying they don't experience contractions and there's not some level of discomfort associated with it, but it appears, if we can anthropomorphize a little bit here with acknowledgement of the animals having emotions, it appears that it's not quite as difficult. So our better models for what birth may have been like in the last common ancestor are probably the sort of large-bodied monkeys. So birth has probably been a fairly tight squeeze for our ancestors, for primates, for a long, long time because of the large heads and the relatively narrow pelvis that we have. But it got even more complicated for humans when we adopted bipedalism somewhere between 5 and 7 million years ago, because a bipedal pelvis is a narrow pelvis. And about 5 to 7 million years ago, for whatever reason, our ancestors' selection favored bipedal locomotion, getting up on two legs. I mean, they didn't do this overnight, but walking on two legs. Major transformations in the shape and the orientation of the pelvis. The selection was operating, as far as we can tell, on locomotion, on movement, and not necessarily on obstetrics at this point. Obstetrics was just, you know, a sort of a byproduct of all this that was going on. But the changes that were taking place in the pelvis requires that the human infant negotiate a series of rotations as it is born. The most important one, for my argument at least, is that in something like 95 to 97% of deliveries, the human infant emerges facing backwards. If you can think about the mother, if you think about the mother lying flat on her back, which is a very unusual way to deliver babies worldwide and physiologically as well, but for the mother in the upright position, the human infant in about 95 to 97% of the cases comes out facing backwards, facing that away. And this is something that puts some challenges, at least, on the human mother. Here's some sketches made from a videotape of a Japanese macaque giving birth. She's on a this is in captivity, so she's on some kind of a bar or something like that. I think giving birth in the trees is fairly common for primates, and thus using hands in delivery is very important for primates. So you can see here the little baby is emerging facing forwards, facing in the same direction that the mother is. She reaches back and she helps to guide it out, pulling it out and typically pulling it up to her breast as far as she can. The placenta is still in, so she may not be able to pull it all the way up, but very soon after the delivery of the placenta, she pulls it up to her breast and the baby begins nursing. She licks the baby. This appears to be very, very common in primates, if not universally distributed. We don't have a lot of observations of primates giving birth under natural circumstances, so this is something that we're always on the lookout for. With humans, you have a different kind of situation. You'll notice that in this drawing, we had the artist depict the mother in the upright position. Most obstetrics texts and birthing books and so on that you come across, she's probably lying down because that's the normal way to give birth. In hospitals at least. But she's squatting, the baby's coming down, facing side to side, again having to go negotiate this series of rotations, coming out, facing backwards. And the difficulty that poses for the mother, if you can imagine, is that she's got to somehow get back there and help to guide that baby out. And the baby, you know, if she pulls it up like this, she risks damaging the nerves in the neck. If the nuchal cord is wrapped, which is actually quite common, she may actually help to strangle the baby as it's coming out. The baby is often covered with birth fluids and mucus that interfere with breathing. She needs, or somebody needs, to help wipe those things out. It's difficult. It's not impossible for her to do that. Women give birth alone all over the world a lot, but not as commonly as one might hope. But our adaptation is to seek assistance at the time of delivery, seek companionship. And the drive to seek a companion at the time of delivery, I would argue, was probably an emotional drive. I don't think that mothers in the EEA or whenever we might be talking about sat and thought, you know, baby's going to come out backwards. I think I better get somebody to help me with this. I think she thought, you know, I don't know what's going on. I'm a little uncertain. I have a little bit of anxiety about this. I think I'm going to go to somebody that makes me feel better, my female companions in most cases, my husband or whatever it might have been, but some other companion. So I think there was an emotional kind of thing. We've talked several times before about the relatively helpless human infant. In general, most primates, most mammals deliver babies with an average of 50% of their bone growth completed at the time of birth. A lot of variation, but it's about 50%, and thus about 50% of the level of maturation in a lot of the motor functions and so on. Our babies are born with only 25% of their brain growth completed at birth, partly because of the impossibility of giving birth to a baby with a much larger head. Babies who gestated a little bit longer and had 30 to 40% would not have been born in the past. But I think also because there was a selective premium for being born at a more undeveloped stage of brain maturation and so on, because of the kind of learning that takes place in the extrauterine environment rather than the sort of learning. We know learning takes place in utero, but more learning perhaps in exposure. Whoops, I'm sorry, I keep doing this. Anyway, so here we have the anatomical changes that for bipedalism and expanded brain size. The bipedalism came about 5 to 7 million years ago, expanded brain size about 2.5 million years ago. So the adaptation to bipedalism came about first. But in one, leading off there, one of them, a narrow pelvis with a large head, infant being less developed at birth, and the fact that the infant typically is born facing away from the mother led the mother, probably, I would argue, for emotional reasons, to seek some sort of assistance at birth. So what we have as an evolutionary legacy for birthing women today is an emotional need for companionship at the time of birth. And this is one of those things that is often not met in the way we construct birth in this society. There's plenty of people there to help. There could be half a dozen technicians and obstetricians and midwives or whatever, but there's not the person who's there just to meet the needs of the mother who is anxious at this time. And we know that anxiety can lead to a number of complications, and oftentimes the anxiety leads to complications that require more medicine, more drugs, as far as the typical approach is concerned. So several of us, Jim mentioned that we work in the field that we call evolutionary medicine, and one of the arguments from evolutionary medicine is that we should take some behaviors, some feelings, some characteristics that really, if we recast them in the EEA in this example, may actually be advantageous kinds of things. So I would argue in this case that mild anxiety, mild fear, mild uncertainty was probably advantageous, and because it led to a successful outcome as a result of seeking companionship, and it should be valued for that. Now, it can get excessive, and then it becomes something that needs a little bit more intervention. Oops, sorry, I keep doing this. Okay, we know that there's some problems if it does become excessive. Try to imagine that cascade that somebody was mentioning earlier, that if you have some assistance there that sort of helps interfere with that or relieve that mild anxiety, a lot of these things don't necessarily happen. You have someone, you get the anxiety, it gets out of control, the fear gets out of control, and a lot of these things can happen. More likelihood that the labor will be speeded up with Pitocin. So a number of the problems that Sue was talking about there. Every one of these has an impact on development, on infant development. I don't need to tell this audience to think about the next step in here because that's what we're focusing on today. But all of these can... did I skip something there? No, there we go. But having support in the form of... I mean, we do have a whole profession of doulas now, but it doesn't have to be somebody that's professionally trained as long as they're not themselves frightened and add to the anxiety. But every single one of these has been shown in a number of studies, including a huge meta-analysis that was published a couple of years ago of about 13,000 women worldwide who had doula support in comparison to those who didn't. Decreased length of labor, decreased C-section rate, decreased use of extraneous Pitocin, and so on. So this is, again, the sort of formulaic approach to it, but how we can recast some of these characteristics that are seen as problems into an adaptation kind of thing or a positive sort of way. So it's a very simple kind of thing, and what we have in evolutionary medicine, we talk about mismatches a lot. So we have these certain needs that women come to labor with, and this is sometimes what they're greeted with. So anyway, a couple of leading on to a few of the other aspects that are worth preserving from my point of view, delivering the upright or squatting position. Again, most of us can't really do that. There's certainly some advantages to it, but we can certainly seek someone to help us sit up in the upright position. That doula can help, our husband can help, our partner, whomever that happens to be, other people can help in that upright position. And these are a number of characteristics that are valued or enhanced as a result of being in that upright position. So that you've got they've documented that the birth canal expands a little bit in that upright position. So that opens things up a little bit, and that probably reduces the stress on the baby and on the mother. The back of the skull, the occiput, is the most developed part of the skull at birth, and that bears the contractions, the force of the contractions. These are very forceful, powerful things that are hammering on this baby, and that bears the force of the contractions in the upright position if the baby is in the head facing backwards position. If they're in the lithotomy position, the flat on the back position, it's the more fragile frontal bones that are bearing that pressure there. So a number of obvious kinds of advantages that would be advantageous not only to the infant and the mother, but also the medical staff or the midwifery staff or whatever. Cutting the cord when it stops pulsating, the cord, what you have immediately after birth is that the baby has a dual source of oxygen. So oxygen coming from the placenta and oxygen coming from the efforts now to fill the lungs and begin normal respiration, postpartum respiration. And for a few minutes there, or a few seconds, usually up to about a minute and a half or 2 minutes, you have the backup system in effect. This was probably very important in the EEA because it does take some time for those normal respirations to get started. So having that backup system is probably pretty good. There are arguments now worldwide for leaving the cord uncut until it stops pulsing because of the fact that most women enter labor and delivery with low iron levels and anemia. Don't separate the mother and the baby in the first hour. I'll just go through this really quickly because I only have 5 minutes left. But part of the problem for this whole idea of the first hour being important after birth began with the studies of Klaus and Kindle, and they were wonderful studies. I mean, what it led to, I think, was wonderful. But in the earliest studies, they said that it was necessary for mothers and babies to be together, for adequate bonding to take place. They changed that. They did not say that in any of their subsequent publications. But this is what kicked things off, because we know we're incredibly flexible species, and there's nothing absolute or critical about that period in the sense of, okay, well, that's it, no chance for bonding. These are some of the things that go on in the first postnatal hour that I observed in my observations of those 250 deliveries. We've already talked about some of these. Every one of them contributes to the development of the infant in that period of time. If you recast those, and don't think too much about them as far as bonding behaviors are concerned, but what might they have added during the EEA? The rubbing and the massaging probably stimulated breathing. The vernix is really high in antibiotics that probably helped to enhance healing. It helped to keep the baby from dehydrating, certainly a warming kind of thing. There's been some discussion of the left side holding, being the exposure to the heartbeat, soothing the infant, less energy expenditure. An infant who is soothed and calm is not spending as much energy and is also better able to bond to the mother. I will quote Allison. I don't know if she still thinks this way, but this is one of the discussions during that period of time when there was so much controversy about that, because I did not think, based on the observations I had made and sort of based on some intuition or something like that, that first hour was an irrelevant period of somebody's life, that it was completely unimportant, and there are lots of reasons for that. But anyway, there's Allison's contribution to that. Breastfeeding initiated and soon after birth is associated with longer duration of breastfeeding and a number of other positive things, and we'll hear in a minute about the significance of breastfeeding, and I think most of us. The second one I think is interesting in light of some of the things that Sue was saying, and that is that in the first few minutes after birth, when the baby roots and nuzzles the nipple, not necessarily latching on, that sends oxytocin through the mother's system, which clamps down that uterus. So it's an attractive idea to think that in the EEA, the baby had a way of saving its mother's life, because postpartum hemorrhage is the number one cause of death related to childbirth in the world today. So there are obviously dyadic kinds of things that are going on. And this is, I think I want to close with this, because there are some things that were not in the EEA that I think we need to rethink in some ways. The Pitocin is one of them, but another one I think is cesarean section. Rates of C-section are going up worldwide, and there are a lot of reasons for that, but the World Health Organization and most people who have looked at this conservatively say that the sort of normal natural rate is probably about 15% of necessary cesarean sections. And you can see that the changes, this came out earlier, I think probably last year in 2009, this concern about the increased rates of cesarean section. It's supposed to be safe. It's not completely risk-free. There are a lot of complications, I think, potential complications. And the only reason this is of concern to me is the increase in the rate of elective cesarean sections. Nobody's going to say, don't have a cesarean section when you need a cesarean section, because lots and lots of people's lives have been saved. A lot of us may not be here today if it hadn't been for the option of cesarean section. But the rate of elective cesarean section is going up. We know that there are some risks for the infants. We know that there are a number of respiratory and other kinds of regulation problems that are associated with it. And then the bonding and the initiation of breastfeeding and those kinds of things are always delayed because of that, too. There appear also to be long-term effects. There's research that's going on right now linking the risk for type 1 diabetes with cesarean section. And there may be a lot more. I think we're just beginning to ask some of these questions. In the 1960s, Ashley Montague, someone was mentioning his work earlier, first came up with the idea that that there's something good about birth. So now I'm going to flip this over. Instead of saying we need to worry about C-section, you know, and maybe so there's some problems associated with that, there may be something positive about birth, about the labor of the contractions of labor and delivery that are being lost when babies are not, with elective at least. So Montague argued that the contractions of labor and delivery replace the licking. It's very, very, I mean, as best I could tell from a worldwide survey of the anthropological literature, there are no reported cultures in which the mother licks the baby. So this is something that is a human universal or non-universal or whatever. And yet there are a lot of things that go on during labor and delivery that may replace some of the stuff that goes on with licking. People were mentioning some of the research that's being done about the significance of licking for the development of infants. And we know that there, the stress hormones, the stress of being born is an advantage up to a point. These might be some recommendations that we would make for babies who have to be delivered by cesarean section for good medical reasons. Maybe we can replace those contractions, you know, maybe a trial of labor so that some of the contractions are actually delivered to the baby. Maybe there's some things that we can do right after that the dad can do or the doula can do or somebody who might be there to offer that kind of skin to skin. We also have now some new evidence about epigenetic differences in C-section. This is a study that was done in 2009, sorry I didn't put the date up there, showing that C-section babies had a higher DNA methylation of white blood cells compared with vaginally born babies. So there's something going on in that process that produces something different from what happens with a vaginal delivery. And it may indeed provide a link between the evidence that we have of C-sections and its effect on later life disease. What's going on here? What's going on in epigenetic kinds of things? And it may provide a link to the developmental disorders that we're talking about in this conference. So a lot of people are beginning to think there is more going on in that first hour after birth than simply, you know, let's get a live baby out of here, or maybe the mother can have a nice little birth experience to write in her journal or something like that. There might be more, but we don't necessarily know too much about them. So a lot of the gene, we talk a lot about gene and environment interaction, and I understand the concept of not really separating those two things at all. But we talk a lot about the prenatal environment, but I don't think there's a whole lot of discussion about the perinatal environment, about that first hour, what might be going on in that period of time. And that's what my final parting word is, that I think if you think about all the things that go on in the first hour after birth, that is probably the most important single hour in a person's life, and we need to pay some more attention to it. Thank you.
Take a question. Go to the microphone, please.
Just a very quick point of I don't know if correcting the record is the right word. Most studies of primates, including the one of the Japanese, are of giving birth are in captivity, where often the vets have isolated the mother. In more social situations, mothers give birth surrounded by family. And one of the very first things they do once they take care of the umbilical cord and stuff like that is to hold the infant up, and everybody examines the genitals. So from day one or from hour one, they know the gender of that animal.
Okay. Thank you very much. Yeah, I know. I'm seeing more and more of these studies of the sort of natural environment studies coming in. Yeah. Thank you.
Wendy, that was really good. There's one other thing you didn't mention that I personally experienced, and I always wondered if maybe it wasn't the first thing that causes a mother to take the baby, and that's the postpartum chill. So women will have, as a result of the loss of the mass, it's something like sort of approaching shock. But I thought, and you showed pictures, the babies being held close to the body. My thinking was, at the time this happened to me, this would be a perfect way of sort of reinforcing the mother's behavior. So she's cold. She doesn't have to think at all. She just grabs the first warm thing. And it's 100, it's like 103 degrees, and she might have dropped to whatever, 96, 97. So the other thing that along the lines of what Dr. Sumi said, the social species are rare in mammals, highly social. Mm-hmm. So if there's no other animal there, you would have the single births. But prairie voles, at mm-hmm. least, we've seen lots of midwifery, including dad, running over. And I believe Kathy Wynn Edwards has similar data from Siberian hamsters. So I think that you have to put that in the context of how the animals mm-hmm. live. And then where there are social species, you have others participating. And humans, of course, are highly social species.
That's a very important point. And I know that there is more and more research being done on this. And many of them cite my work and say she's wrong, which is great. I mean, that's one of the reasons we do this kind of research, to stimulate people to, you know, prove me wrong. I think it just advances knowledge. Thank you.
I was just wondering if you know if there have been any studies on the delayed cord cutting and if it has any effect on things like clotting factors or jaundice and the neonate?
There's a lot of work. And I actually have a lot of the papers, and maybe somebody in here can answer that question a little bit better. But there has been a whole lot about that, because the World Health Organization is recommending that it be delayed, that they not cut it. ACOG has not said anything. They're not recommending for it or against it. And it seems like the weight of the evidence is for delayed cutting, from my reading of the literature. And there are lots and lots of reasons for that. And I can't specifically answer the question about jaundice, but I know that's one of the things that's discussed about it in the study. Sorry.
What is the birthing position of the binole?
Yeah, I've been trying to find out if anybody's recorded any births, bonobo births. And I am not aware. Is that what you asked about?
Yes, right.
Yeah, I have not been able to track anything down. I have not contacted Franz Duval, and I could do that. But I have not heard anything about births in bonobos.
Thank
Lots
you.
Of records of people coming in and the baby was born during the night, but no one has at least recorded in literature that I can access via the internet, and Medline and so on has recorded an actual birth. And I've been trying, because I think the close correspondence between the head and the pelvis is probably more similar to humans than it is than the chimpanzee, orangutan, the great apes, the great, great apes. I think there's probably a close, and I'd like to know whether the baby is what direction.
Last question. Hi, thank you for your presentation. I've heard recently that there's some recognition with C-sections that babies, because they're not encountering the vaginal secretions that they would normally encounter and ingest, this might set them up for asthma and allergy-related. Yeah. And there's some interesting attempts to expose the baby to that that's been born by C-section. I don't know how common that is, but I wondered if you were familiar with that and had anything to add.
I do know that's one of the concerns, is the fact that there's some good stuff about that microflora and so on that the baby's exposed to. And the vernix passing over the mother's perineum is actually enhances the healing of the cuts and nicks and abrasions that happen. So again, it's one of those two-way street kinds of things. But I don't know the details on that one. But I think I have to
Thank
shut up
again.
And go sit down.
Thanks.